Hello. Hi, Lars.
Hi.
Hi, everyone.
I'm good.
Hello.
Good.
Yeah? You're doing well?
Yeah, I'm fine. Still holding up. And how about you? This is quite a marathon for you.
Well,
amazing. I've heard that you're writing a book during the same time as well.
I'm taking notes for future use.
All right.
You know, but much of it's ending up on our blog. Mm. So, well, I have lots of questions for you.
All right.
But let's start with just maybe an overview. Can I say that you're in charge of the West Kowloon culture?
No, you can't. No, you can't.
Fine. You explain what you do. How would you characterize your...
No, I'm in charge of the museum part of West Kowloon, or the visual culture part of it. Because then there will be concert halls and Cantonese opera buildings and so forth.
And you're totally...
I'm involved in it because we're part of the whole, but I'm not in charge of that.
Okay. So, M+.
Yes.
What's it going to be? Let's lay it out. I mean, I know that the Hong Kong audience will know the story, but people who aren't
here... Well, I don't think that's... Even though we've been talking about it and talking, especially for the last year, when we've sort of formulated what it's about. I mean, when you say you're building a concert hall, most people understand what it is and they can sort of visualize it.
Yes.
But when you say that we're building a museum for visual culture in Hong Kong and it's called M+, I think it more triggers question marks. What is that? What does it mean? What are you going to do?
Yep.
So, I suppose that's your question then.
I mean, yeah. I read about this.
And basically, I mean, what we're trying to create is a museum that, without insulting anyone, I mean, probably doesn't exist in Asia, and probably doesn't exist in the world actually, but a museum that has, I mean, on a certain level and professionally and so forth, is on par with the great museums that we have in the West that we sort of trust and that do a really phenomenal job from a museological point of view, great at meeting the audience, taking care of the artists and all of that, but at the same time creating a museum that actually is for this place and is of this place and of this time. And of course this all sounds like rhetoric, so it has to be concrete as well. This project rests on three basic pillars. One is that it's a very ambitious project. It's large. I mean, there's a lot of money involved. It has a fantastic piece of land. It's meant to be towards 60,000 square meters, which is basically the size of the Museum of Modern Art in New York. And it's also ambitious in terms of having the ambition to set a new standard for museum practice, I think, in Asia. And at the same time, it's also, and I think that's really important, and some raise their eyebrows when they hear that. I think it's really important to remember that it has a strong public service ethos. This is not a tourist project. And hoping again that I don't offend anyone, but I mean, this is not Abu Dhabi. This is Hong Kong. This is a project for the people who live and work in Hong Kong. And I think that all successful museums actually, that and the museums we all love and like to visit again and again, they're actually rooted in one place and are rooted there. So it's really public service. And finally, it's a museum where when I was asked to come on board, they told me these things and then they said, but also we want you to challenge the givens, to challenge the existing models of what a museum can be, even though it's a big project. And that's a rather unusual combination of being asked to be challenging and building something grand at the same time. And that made it very attractive.
But how are you tackling that? I mean, that's what I'm interested in, is the question of these, what kind of new exhibition spaces can emerge from all these big projects that are happening all over the world. I mean, and in what ways can you define what a museum is? I mean, how can you build a museum and then also undermine or reconfigure the idea of a museum?
I think that's a good question, because I do think that it's very easy to venture into something that you don't define as a museum, that you define as something else, there are all these words for it,
sure,
platform or et cetera, et cetera. And I do think that actually to create something that is recognizable as a museum, that someone thinks when they sort of go to a place or take in what is being produced by this place, that they think that it's a museum that does it. And I think that partly has to do with the importance of the museum as a symbolic or as a symbol in a time when the concept of art is expanding. So you, in a sense, you need an anchor then, and the museum is important as an anchor. So the challenge is to maintain a sense of museum. And of course, at the core of a museum is the fact that you're basically, well, I mean, what you do in a museum is that you create a platform, that we have the word, where people, where art and artists meet an audience, but also where you have a collection which functions as a reference and some sort of base for all activities that are going on. So it's a place where you are at the same time an arena for contemporary discourse and something that, a place that constructs and reconstructs history in a sense. And I think it's absolutely critical to remember that a museum is not the same as a building.
So we're trying to create something. Why does a museum need to be a big building?
I think the reason why we're still thinking about a building is mainly because I think we have to admit that there are still, well, let's say we'll probably build a collection that has a 30-40 year perspective to start with. And so if you look back historically, and if you look at a lot of artistic practice now, there are still artists, definitely, who are longing for great white cubes and black boxes.
They need a roof.
They need a roof, and they need certain types of spaces. And then, but you also have to be aware of the fact that there are other artists who actually are not longing for those spaces, where you need a digital space, or you need to be able to work in other types of spaces, or if they want to do something in a treetop, right, you have to find the tree and do something in that treetop with them, even if it's outside the building. So, I mean, a museum is not the building, but the building is a tool, I think.
Hmm. But if the institution as a totality becomes fixed in the building, you know, then you're running the risk of folding yourself back into just being a building.
Yeah, the world is full of risks, right? And you have to, art and culture is about risk.
Yeah, but what I liked about the project that's currently up at the moment is that, you know, there are these pieces that are installed all throughout the city, which I thought was interesting just because, like, before you have your building, you have a set of programming in which you're doing all of these things that are, very anti-museum, anti the ethos of a building by putting artwork out in the city. And so I just wanted to ask you whether, like, once you have the building, is then all the art just going to end up
in
there?
No, I mean, it is a challenge. I mean, I've been through this once before, in a sense, because when I, my previous job, which was as director of, when I came from London and became a director of the Moderna Museet in Stockholm, which is a classic museum of modern art, the first thing I had to do was to close that building because it was a sick building and the staff were falling ill. And we had to decide to close it for 2 years. And basically we created a nomadic museum, a museum without a building for 2 years. And I mean, of course, when it actually was time to move back into that building after 2 years, and we've had a great program going on around the city and around the whole country, a lot of people said that, oh, you really don't, do you really need that building? And then we started to think about what is it that we can and what that we can't do. And of course, it turns out that there are lots of things you can't do if you don't have a proper building where you have proper security, proper climate, and so forth. There are lots of works of art that still require that, and especially if you want to work historically.
Yes.
But the challenge is then to, we thought, and actually we did continue a program that continued what we called Moderna Museet Care Of, which was like similar to Mobile M Plus that we have launched now.
Yep.
But then when you started talking to artists and say, hey, you know, you contact them and say that, well, you've always worked outside in the community or done community-related projects. We would like to do something with you now. And, you know, 9 cases out of 10, they said, oh, but I really would like to, you know, do a proper work in a proper gallery space. So it's a bit of a challenge. It's not only the institution. I think it's also that many actually have dreams of these kind of spaces and the sort of institutional framework.
Yeah, so, but I always think that's the irony of is that in bringing artists into the museum space, you actually end up in a lot of ways. I mean, that may be their vision, but then you end up having them kind of contradict their own practices.
Well, but that's their choice, isn't it?
I think my
view on how we should think as curators and museum directors is that, I mean, of course, a museum is about audience and public, but we exist because there is this thing we call art, and there are artists. And basically, I think that the museum should always be following in the dance and being led by the art, and we should be prepared to redefine and rethink what we're doing and actually close the building if no one wants the building. But at the same time, if artists do want that building and they have dreams about realizing something, you know, under a roof, we should also follow in that
of
dance.
Course. But I mean, one thing that's been, I mean, that interested I know what me you're about the Hong Kong
at,
art
course,
scene
yeah.
Is it's one of these art scenes that has been quite resourceful precisely because of a lack of really proper institutions, and that a lot of the identities of artists' practices have come out of having to come up with either alternative spaces or alternative needs, you know. And then when the infrastructure changes kind of from the top down, then there is this concern or worry that, you know, artist practices will then be brought inside, you know, in very literal terms, into this institutional space. And
I mean, you're
saying that it's up to the artists, which I hope it will be, you know, as you're saying. But I also think that the allure of these spaces creates, you know, redefines what the whole city's infrastructure is going to look like.
In the same
way that the opening of a commercial gallery or the beginnings of commercial enterprise in an art city then change the way that artists relate to one another, you know, or to their audience. You know, they start making works just for shows. People become aligned with certain galleries. I mean, the system changes both at the level of agents and then also at the level of the infrastructure.
But I mean, it's always like this. I mean, it's not only in the art world. The world changes, and you can sometimes regret that these changes happen, but it can also put you in a very difficult situation if you sort of try to maintain a situation which is not relevant anymore. So I think that you just have to sort of follow the development and not moralize too much about it, and actually always remember that, you know, it's about the art and the artists. And usually if let's say because this is something we can fear, that of course, that when the market gets really strong, that it starts defining our many artists' practices. Usually there are other artists popping up somewhere else that actually are totally outside that system and do the great things. So it's just about having your eyes in the right place also.
I mean, I'm being a little unfair because also Hong Kong does have an art museum.
That is true.
I mean, we've both neglected that.
I don't deny that.
But, you know, and in a way, its relationship to the city's artists is exactly what you're talking about. I mean, you know, as a possibility, like the programming is not particularly involved with a certain part of the Hong Kong art scene, and therefore it's not utilized by them, you know, and it has kind of no relationship to more cutting edge or more experimental practices.
No, I mean, they also do. They are, with relatively limited space, they're trying to do very many things
sure.
at the same time. So,
yep.
Absolutely.
Yep.
That was a diplomatic answer.
I would expect nothing less. You live here, I don't. But so the collection, in terms of a collection of 30, 40 years, is this going to focus on Hong Kong's art scene, the regional art scene, international? How are you going to define those parameters?
Well, basically, we're thinking in the same way as Western museums tend to think,
yep.
that you're best at what is close to you, and you are sort of more strategic about things that are further away. So when you're in the, say, Centre Pompidou and you walk around in the collection there of the museum, of course, you never doubt that you're in Paris, that you're in France, that you're in Europe,
yep.
but you're also in the world. And of course, when they acquire works from China or Brazil or so, they are quite strategic about what they buy and how that relates to the core. So the aim with our collection is to create a collection which basically you think about it as concentric circles. So Hong Kong at the core, China, Asia, the rest and the West, mm-hmm. in a sense. So, and of course, and you collect in very different ways then also.
And why this 30 to 40 year idea?
I mean, this is actually still a guesstimate in a sense. I mean, the main discussion we have now, and that we, things we need to develop in terms of the acquisition sort of strategy, is where we start the different stories, because we're collecting both art, design, architecture, and moving image cinema. Yeah. And I mean, if you say yes, Chinese contemporary art, it has almost a given starting time in the end of the 70s. But Hong Kong, the Hong Kong story, you may want to start a little bit earlier. And Hong Kong cinema also has a certain, you know, start date, which is sort of might move a little bit, while if you look at design, again, you might choose. But it's somewhere there. I think that for the collection, the likely starting point is 60s, 70s, somewhere there in most areas. And then the exhibitions can, of course, wander around freely. They can be 19th century if needed, or they can be about other types of material, different parts of the world. So that's sort of the complement and the challenge to the collection also.
And in terms of education or historical or scholarship, I mean, are there plans to acquire also archives and artists' papers? And then also, what about the existing city's archival institutions?
I mean, of course, there is. I mean, Hong Kong is privileged to have Asia Art Archive here.
Yeah,
and of course, we're totally aware of each other, and we're talking to each other to see how we can sort of find ways of working together, because we shouldn't go out and try to duplicate what they are doing so phenomenally well.
Yep. But then you're going to end up with the objects, and they're going to end up with the papers.
That's possible, but then we should see to that we create the right kind of links between us, so they make sense together. Yep. But then, of course, in terms of research, I mean, an institution like ours definitely should have a very strong research department. But we may work with their library.
And then what about M Plus's relationship to the other existing, say, nonprofits, places like Videotage? And, I mean, how do you kind of imagine that ideally, say, like, what would be the ideal case?
Well, I think that I mean, in most cities that are culturally alive and have a good energy, in a sense, of course, you have many voices and you have, in a sense, an ecology that works.
Yeah.
You have small,
fish,
mid-sized,
fish,
large, and they work. And in a way, I think it's important for us not to be too big and too dominating, so we suffocate the other institutions. And I actually personally spend a lot of time and energy on trying to see to that the central police headquarters actually becomes what we all hope it would be, because I think that's really important for the ecology of Hong Kong, in a sense. And I think that the smaller Parasite, Videotage, and so forth, it's extremely important that they have enough resources that they can maintain their own voice. And I mean, occasionally we may work together, but I think also it's important that they actually stay independent.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, at least in terms of what you're saying, like, one, Hong Kong does have this existing ecology, but yeah, on the sort of smaller, mid-size level already, which is what makes it special in a way, because so many new cities that are receiving new museums, you know, either are just going to end up with a massive institution and no middle institutions or no even commercial galleries, which, you know, never seems like a successful model for creating the lower parts of the system.
Exactly.
I'm not going to call it the food chain, but
No, it is not a food chain, actually. It is an ecology. It's different.
Yes, exactly. It's much more of an ecology. Anyway, but I mean, I'm hopeful that this is going to be a successful venture for you guys. But what's the timeline? I mean, how is this going to play out in the next
time? I mean,
decade?
Basically, we're moving on. There are four fronts that we're moving on in parallel. And I mean, sometimes when we're cocky, we claim that the museum has already opened because Mobile M Plus exists. We're doing exhibitions. We do have a public program. I hope that we will be able within this year to sort of make some major steps in terms of the collection, so that we will be, in a sense, more material. There is a team growing. And then, of course, the timeline usually, and maybe that's what you mean also, that we talk about the building.
Oh, the whole thing.
And the building, I mean, we will launch the architecture competition for the museum building August, September, I hope, which means that in 10 months from now, we will have a decision on an architect. And according to the consultants, we will have a big building in October 2017. So 5.5 years from now. So we will do a lot of exhibitions and projects before then.
Okay. And then in terms of collecting, I mean, so you, in a way you're going to build the collection and the building simultaneously. Any idea about how much of the building is going to be devoted to the collection? And
yes, I mean, we depending on the final design, of course, we expect to have somewhere between 17 and 20,000 square meters exhibition space. And of course, this is, it's important to remember that this is also a moving image. It's design, it's architecture,
yep.
And it's a lot of quite space-hungry installations, I assume,
yep.
and works of art.
Yep.
So it's not a MoMA full of clay paintings. So it's not the number of works that they have.
Yep.
I think it can be quite flexible, but I would assume that about 10 to 12,000 square meters would be for various aspects of the collection.
Okay.
Over time, and 3 to 5,000, something like that, for temporary exhibitions. Normally, a museum cannot program. I mean, without it gets really expensive, and you go crazy more than 3-4,000 square meters of exhibitions.
Yep. And one last thought about question about the cinema, like when M Plus is kind of cinema project is going to debut, and then also this is something I don't know as much about at all, but the relationship or like Hong Kong's current film and cinema culture, and then you know, how the museum will function in relation to that. I mean, are there existing archives of cinema?
Yes, there is a Hong Kong Film Archive, which is an archive with quite limited possibilities for screening and exhibition.
Yep.
So they might be an asset for us in terms of actually, because they hold a lot of Hong Kong, especially Hong Kong cinema history.
Yep.
We're actually, in the coming weeks, we're interviewing a curator with focus on moving image and cinema.
Okay.
So that we will have someone who has that as his or her main focus. And of course, already at Chinese New Year, we had a marathon screening of Hong Kong cinema with special focus on Cantonese opera. I mean, the thing where Cantonese opera plays some sort of role in them, which was attended by 4,000 people during one day. So it was amazing. There's a great interest in it.
Yep.
So this is something that we're sort of working on in parallel with a sort of proper art collection.
I mean, even though it's not something I know as much about as art, I think that is a great attribute of M Plus, is that because cinema is something that people will come to see along with art, and also I don't know, cinema is also so heavily commercialized, at least in Europe and America, but there's also this pent-up demand for kind of older, better screenings of 35mm films, and
you know, yes,
and it's material that now needs to be preserved and conserved. So,
absolutely.
And museums can do that now in the ways that movie theaters cannot.
Exactly, because we have a funding that is fit for doing that. Basically, I think that's the most straightforward reason why we can do it, and actually cinemas can't.
Okay, well, I look
different
forward to
system.
Learning about Hong Kong cinema when I come see the
okay.
art.
Brilliant.
Thank you, Lars. Much
thank
appreciated.
You. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks. Well, thanks for listening.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it.
Pleasure.